So good morning everyone, today we will be dealing with a condition called gestational trophoblastic disease, which is a spectrum varying from benign to malignant conditions. So how we will define gestational trophoblastic disease, and what is the classification that we have, and what about the genetics, and what are the risk factors for this condition and the pathology, and how do these women present to us with this condition, and how we are going to diagnose, and what is the treatment for this. And sometimes we do encounter cases of molar pregnancy and with a twin pregnancy or a multiple pregnancy, and having treated, what should be the follow-up of these women, and because these conditions can turn into malignancy, so called choriocarcinoma. So we have a FIGO scoring system, and based on that we classify this neoplasia into low risk and high risk, and then how we manage low risk GDN and high risk GDN, and what should be the long term outcome. So once we treat this condition, choriocarcinoma, what should be the long term outcome, and having treated this condition, what should be the contraception for this woman. So this is in fact in history it is described as it is the God's first cancer and the man's first cure, because this is the only malignancy where we have 100% cure, or I can say it is a 95% cure rate based on whether it is a low risk or a high risk GTN. So it is basically a group of pregnancy related disorders arising from placental trophoblast cells. So if we see the types of gestational trophoblastic disease, we classify into those conditions where villi are seen and those without villi. So with villi, we usually say that it is a hydatidiform mole, and again in hydatidiform mole we have a complete mole and a partial mole, and then we have an invasive mole or a persistent mole and cholangiocarcinoma. And in conditions without villi, we see there are placental site nodules and plaques, and placental site trophoblastic tumor, epithelioid trophoblastic tumor, and of course the choriocarcinoma. So coming to the FIGO classification, in hydatidiform mole we have a complete molar pregnancy and the partial molar pregnancy, and in GTN we have these neoplastic conditions varying from invasive mole, choriocarcinoma, PSTT, and epithelioid trophoblastic tumor. If you see the incidence of this trophoblastic disease and trophoblastic neoplasia, so it is based on the histological subtype that we have seen. So if you see the partial hydatidiform mole, it is 1 in 695 pregnancies, and complete hydatidiform mole is 1 in 945 pregnancies, and invasive mole is it usually follows 15 to 20% of cases following a complete hydatidiform mole, whereas following a partial hydatidiform mole, it is only 0.5 to 1.7%. And if you see the incidence of choriocarcinoma, so it is in fact very rare in European countries, and the incidence is only 0.02 to 0.05 per 1000 pregnancies. Whereas in Southeast Asian countries, a bit high incidence is seen, varying from 0.4 to 2 per 1000 pregnancies. And 2 to 3% follows a complete hydatidiform mole, and less than 0.5% follow a partial hydatidiform molar pregnancy. And if you see the incidence of the other invasive types, that is the persistent placental site trophoblastic tumor, so the incidence is 1 per 1 lakh pregnancies, and it accounts for 1 to 2% of GTN. And epithelioid trophoblastic tumor accounts for less than 1% of GTN. So if you see the epidemiology, so this condition tends to be more common in Southeast Asian countries, 7 to 10 times higher in Southeast Asian countries. And in Taiwan, the incidence is very common, that is 1 in 125 live births. Whereas in European countries, as we have just seen, it is a bit rare. And 90% of first trimester partial moles are usually misclassified as non-molar abortions. So coming to the risk factors for this condition, so the most important risk factors being the age, so extremes of reproductive age, so very young woman and late reproductive age. So the incidence is, in fact, it is increased 20 times in women less than 15 years, whereas in women more than 45 years, the incidence is increased 100 times, and in women more than 50 years, it is in fact 200 times increased. So age is considered to be the most important risk factor. And the other most important risk factor being a previous history of molar pregnancy. So in cases where there is a previous history of molar pregnancy, the recurrence is 1 in 55 to 1 in 10. And also this condition tends to be common in women where it seems there is a carotene deficiency, and also where there are mutations in NLRP7 gene, that is the caterpillar protein family on the chromosome 19q. So again, this condition tends to be common. And also contraception, that is the usage of oral contraceptive pills, is also considered to be a risk factor for this condition. And when it comes to the parity and the blood group, the paternal age, and the smoking and alcohol consumption, the role of these is a bit controversial in the causation of this condition. Coming to the genetics, so in the normal conception, we usually see there will be two sets of genes. So one is a paternal gene, the other is the maternal gene, so resulting in a normal fetus. So this is what happens in a normal conception. So one paternal gene and the other is from maternal condition, from maternal gene, so resulting in a normal fetus. Whereas in complete mole, so in we have two sets of paternal genes, and in fact the maternal gene is inactivated. So you don't find any maternal genes in a complete mole, so there is no fetal formation. So in a complete mole, usually we don't see any fetus. We have only two sets of paternal genes, and there are no maternal genes, and there is no fetus in a complete mole. Whereas in a partial mole, so usually it is a triploidy most of the times. In 90% of the times it is triploidy. So two sperms and one maternal gene. So you have three sets of genes. So resulting in a 69XXY cells. So you have here in a partial mole both the maternal and paternal chromosomes, unlike you see in a complete mole where there is no presence of a maternal genetic material or a maternal chromosome. So this is what you see in a partial molar pregnancy. So if you see again the genetic basis of a monospermic complete hydatidiform mole, so here you can see that there is loss of maternal chromosome, so and you find there is only duplication of paternal chromosomes. So there is important thing is there is loss of maternal chromosome and there is duplication of paternal chromosomes. So this is what happens in a monospermic complete hydatidiform mole. Whereas in a dispermic complete hydatidiform mole, so here two sperms try to are present, and there is again inactivation of the maternal chromosome. So this is diploidization, and this is nothing but the dispermic complete hydatidiform mole. So this is the partial mole I was talking. So there will be three sets of genes, so one maternal and two paternal, but in fact the fetus, though it is formed or though it is present, usually it tends to be non-viable, because most often it is this fetus will be associated with lot of anomalies. So mostly it will be a non-viable fetus in a partial molar pregnancy. So coming to the differences between complete and partial molar pregnancy, so in a complete mole, the origin is, it is a monospermic or a dispermic fertilization of an empty ovum. So in a complete hydatidiform mole, it is the empty ovum. Whereas in a partial mole, it is the dispermic fertilization of the ovum. So ovum is always present in a partial mole. So this is the basic difference between a complete and a partial mole. So in a complete mole, there is the fertilization of either a monosperm or a disperm of an empty ovum. Whereas in a partial mole, it is dispermic fertilization of the ovum. And if you see the karyotype, So in a complete mole, it is all diploid and of only paternal origin. So 90% is of monospermic fertilization, that is 46XX. Only 10% tend to be a dispermic fertilization, resulting in either a 46XX or a 46XY. Whereas in a partial molar pregnancy, we have here even the presence of an ovum. So you have both paternal and maternal origin. So in 90% of the cases, it tends to be a triploid one. So either 69XXY or 69XYY or 69XXX is same. And only in 10% of the cases, you see there is a tetraploid or a mosaic pattern. And if you see the prevalence of complete mole is only 1 per 1000 pregnancies, whereas if it is a partial mole, it is 3 per 1000 pregnancies. And in complete mole, you don't find any presence of fetal tissue or even fetal red blood cells, whereas in a partial mole, most often you tend to see a fetus, but it tends to be abnormal. And coming to the histopathology, the difference between a complete and a partial mole is, in a complete mole, you find that the changes are gross or diffuse. So here you see that there is a diffuse villous hydrops, and the trophoblast hyperplasia tends to be diffuse. So macroscopically, in fact, you find the villi to be cystic, and it gives the appearance of a cluster of grapes. So that is a complete mole. So here you find the changes tend to be diffuse. So you find there is diffuse villous hydrops, and then there is diffuse trophoblast hyperplasia, so resulting in the appearance of a cluster of grapes. Whereas in a partial mole, usually we find that the changes tend to be very focal or scattered. So here you find there is focal villous hydrops with scattered abnormally sized scalloped villi, and the trophoblast hyperplasia also tends to be focal. So, and you find there is presence of fetal tissue. So this is the histopathology. So in complete mole, the changes tend to be diffuse, whereas in a partial mole, the changes tend to be very focal. And coming to the immunohistochemistry, in a complete mole, P57 is not expressed, whereas in a partial mole, P57 is expressed, because it is expressed by the maternal allele on the cytotrophoblast and the villous mesenchyme. And because in partial mole you have a maternal allele, this P57 is expressed. So because maternal ovum is not there in the complete mole, the P57 is not expressed in a complete mole, whereas this P57 is expressed in a partial molar pregnancy. And coming to the FISH, or the fluorescence in situ hybridization, it's a genetic DNA bloody status test. So it distinguishes that it is a diploid nature, whereas in partial it is a triploid. And the risk of requiring chemotherapy for persisting either a GTD or a GTN is 15% in complete mole, whereas it is 0.5% in a partial molar pregnancy. So these are the gross differences between these two molar pregnancies. So basically, in a uniform mole, you have a complete mole and a partial mole. So if you see the origin of this complete mole, you have here the ovum is empty, and there can be monospermic or a dispermic fertilization of an empty ovum. Whereas in a partial mole, it is the dispermic fertilization of ovum. And karyotype tends to be diploid in nature in complete, whereas it is triploid or tetraploid in a partial molar pregnancy. And the prevalence is also high in cases of partial, it is 3 per 1000 pregnancies. And in complete mole, you don't find any presence of any fetal tissue, whereas in partial mole, you find a fetus which always tries to be a bit abnormal. And coming to the histopathology, the changes that you see tend to be complete or diffuse in complete molar pregnancy, whereas these changes tend to be focal or scattered in a partial molar pregnancy. And if you do, or if you go for a immunohistochemistry, because P57 is expressed by the maternal allele, you find that the P57 is expressed in a partial mole, whereas it is not in a case of complete mole. and it is diploid in nature in a complete, whereas it is triploid or tetraploid in a partial molar pregnancy. And the chances of turning into malignancy is high in a case of complete mole. So in 15% of the cases, they require chemotherapy because either this condition tends to go on for a neoplasia, whereas it is only 0.5% in a case of partial molar pregnancy. So this is what is a complete hydatidiform mole with grape-like clusters, because the changes tend to be gross or diffuse, giving rise to this appearance of grape-like clusters. So coming to the presentation, so how these women usually present? So in 97% of these cases, women come to us in early pregnancy or in the early weeks of pregnancy with vaginal bleeding. So this vaginal bleeding may be accompanied by abdominal cramps or abdominal discomfort or abdominal pain. So the most common presentation, that is in 97% of these cases, they present to us with a complaint of vaginal bleeding in the early weeks of pregnancy, which may or may not be accompanied by abdominal discomfort or abdominal pain. And the other unusual presentations, so because with the advent of early pregnancy ultrasound, so this condition is being diagnosed even before the woman comes to us with different kind of presentations. So most often this is this condition is picked up in the early pregnancy scan. So most often it is the atypical presentations or nowadays are not seen. So previously we used to see atypical presentations because of the lack of ultrasound in the early pregnancy. So previously we used to see the atypical presentations of this condition, so either in the form of hyperemesis. So 25% of the cases tend to present to us with hyperemesis. So once a woman comes with hyperemesis, so most often it is either because of a multiple pregnancy or a molar pregnancy. So remember, whenever a woman comes to us with the hyperemesis gravidarum, most often we need to always rule out either the presence of a multiple pregnancy or a molar pregnancy. So we need to always do an ultrasound and confirm or rule out at least two conditions. And because of the excessive proliferation of the trophoblast that we see in this condition, so sometimes these women come to us with a large for gestational age uterus, they can present to us with a pelvic mass. So usually the size of the uterus will not correspond to the period of gestation. So because of the abnormal trophoblastic proliferation that we seen, especially with the complete molar pregnancy, so they can present to us with a pelvic mass either because of the uterine enlargement or because of the presence of theca lutensis because of the excessive elevation of beta HCG that we see in this condition. And because of the lack of Liker and because of the excessive proliferation, if we feel the uterus, so usually it gives us a Duffy feel of the uterus. And in 50% of the cases, there can be a prominent theca lutensis that can present to us with a pelvic mass sometimes. And previously, again, women used to present to us with early onset preeclampsia because of the excess elevation of HCG that we see in this condition. And in less than 10% of the women used to present to us with features or signs and symptoms of hyperthyroidism. And less than 2% of these women can present to us with even hemoptysis because of the presence of pulmonary metastasis that we see in this condition. So this is how usually women with this condition present to us. So most often it is, remember, in the early weeks she comes to us with vaginal bleeding with or without pain abdomen. So that is the most common presentation. So any woman who present to us in early weeks with bleeding PB with or without pain abdomen, of the cases they used to even present with hemoptysis because of the presence of pulmonary metastasis. So having diagnosed this condition, so the investigations that we are supposed to do are, of course, the serum beta HCG and the full blood count and the liver function test, their kidney function test in the form of urea, creatinine and electrolytes, and of course the thyroid function test. And we need to always do a chest x-ray to rule out pulmonary pulmonary metastasis. And of course, we need to always do an ultrasound. One is to confirm the diagnosis and also to know whether there are any presence of theca lutein cysts. So in the ultrasound, so in a complete mole, so usually in the ultrasound it shows that the pregnancy is an embryonic and it gives rise to a snowstorm appearance because of the presence of a complete proliferation of this trophoblast, which gives appearance of a snowstorm appearance. Whereas in a partial mole, because the changes tend to be locofocal or sparse, there will be cystic spaces seen in the placenta, and the ratio of transverse to anteroposterior diameters of the gestational sac will be more than 1.5. So this is how we diagnose this molar pregnancy, either a complete or a partial mole, on the ultrasound based on these appearances. So in a complete mole, it is always the snowstorm appearance, whereas in a partial mole, we see that there are cystic spaces in placenta, and then the ratio of transverse to AP diameter of the gestational sac is more than 1.5. So this is the snowstorm appearance that usually we see. Excuse me. So this is the snowstorm appearance that you see in a complete molar pregnancy. So if you see the sensitivity and specificity of ultrasound in the diagnosis of this condition, so the sensitivity is 44%, the specificity is 74%, and the positive predictive value is almost 88%, and the negative predictive value is only 23%. So coming to this tumor marker, that is HCG, so as such we do not have any consensus on a cutoff level, and this may not be diagnostic. And usually this tumor marker is measured as a baseline for monitoring if the molar pregnancy is suspected. So we need to always do a serum beta HCG. One is, it serves as a baseline for us to further monitor the condition after the treatment of this condition. So it serves as a baseline for monitoring if this condition is suspected. So coming to the evacuation of a molar pregnancy, so once we diagnose this condition, so based on the clinical presentation, and once we confirm the diagnosis after doing an ultrasound and the tumor marker, where usually this marker is tends to be elevated, so having diagnosed this condition, so we need to always go for the management, which is nothing but your suction curettage. So you need to always go for evacuation of a molar pregnancy. So what is the best method? So should we go for a surgical method or a medical method? And do we need any cervical preparation before going for a suction curettage? And what about the role of oxytocin infusion? So should we routinely use or not? So coming to the evacuation of a molar pregnancy, so mostly if it is a complete molar pregnancy, we need to always go for a suction curettage. Whereas in a partial mole, so it all depends upon the presence of a fetus or a knot. So if the fetus is not well formed, and depending upon the gestational age, we can again go for a suction curettage. Whereas if a fetus is a bit formed, so you cannot go for a suction curettage, wherein you can or you need to always go for a medical evacuation. So in the partial mole, it is either a suction curettage or a medical evacuation that can be used. And when it comes to the medical evacuation, so the data with mifepristone and misoprostol are limited. And whenever you go for a medical management in these cases, so we need to always do a urine pregnancy test at 3 weeks after medical management, if at all, because we are going for a medical management, we do not have any products of conception for us to send for histology. So always a urine pregnancy test has to be done at 3 weeks after medical management. And remember, always these women need anti-D prophylaxis if a woman is an Rh negative pregnancy. So ideally in complete mole we need not give an anti-D prophylaxis, but because it takes time for us for the histopathology report to come, so it is better if a woman is Rh negative, it is always advisable to go for an anti-D prophylaxis after this procedure. So remember, the treatment for this condition is, for a complete mole it is suction curettage, whereas for a partial mole it is either a suction curettage or a medical evacuation, because sometimes a fetus is there and you cannot do a suction curettage, wherein we need to resort for a medical evacuation. And once you go for medical management, it is always advisable to do a urine pregnancy test at 3 weeks. And if a woman is Rh negative, it is better to give anti-D prophylaxis. So coming to the cervical preparation, so the preparation of the cervix immediately prior to evacuation is safe. So most often the prostaglandin that is advised to be used is a 400 microgram single dose of this misoprostol just 1 hour prior to the suction curettage is considered to be safe. So prolonged usage of these cervical preparations, prolonged use of this prostaglandins are not advisable, and we need to always avoid this prolonged cervical preparation with prostaglandin. So most often we use a single dose of 400 micrograms of misoprostol before suction curettage, so that which is considered to be safe. So coming to the oxytocin infusions, so prior to completion of evacuation, it is not at all recommended. So whenever you are going for this suction curettage, we should never go for oxytocin infusion in this condition, because there is a theoretical risk of causing dissemination of this trophoblastic tissue through the entire venous system. So these oxytocin infusions are ideally not at all recommended while we are doing this procedure of suction curettage, because there is always a risk of causing dissemination of this trophoblastic tissue through the venous system. So the role of oxytocin infusion in case of suction curettage in this condition is, if at all there is a significant hemorrhage prior to the evacuation, then we might consider using this oxytocin infusion. And wherein in case where the woman is bleeding, so where we need to always go for a surgical evacuation, or we need to expedite this procedure, then comes the role of oxytocin infusion. And then the need for oxytocin infusion has to be weighed up against the risk of tumor embolization. So that is the role of oxytocin infusion in cases of treatment of this condition. So prior to completion of evacuation, ideally it is not recommended as a routine. Only in case where a woman comes to us with a significant amount of bleeding prior to the evacuation, then only we need to consider giving this oxytocin infusion, because we need to expedite the process of suction curettage. And then the need for oxytocin infusion has to be weighed up against the risk of causing tumor embolization. So remember, as a routine, we should not go for oxytocin infusion. And then having done, we need to always send the products of conception for histopathology. So the histological assessment is, whenever it is a failed pregnancy, either we go for a medical or a surgical management, we need to always go for a histological assessment of the products of conception. And whenever we do a repeat evacuations also, we need to always send the tissue for histological assessment or histopathology. And otherwise, for a terminated viable pregnancy, this is not routinely needed. And then this material should be sent, or we need to go for a immunohistochemistry to know whether it is a partial or a complete molar pregnancy. So always, once you do this procedure, once you are done with the suction curettage, Remember, we need to always send the products for histopathology. So, and the other indications where we need to always go for histopathology is after all failed pregnancies. So, be it a medical or a surgical management, after all failed pregnancies, we need to always go for a histological assessment. And in all cases where we go for repeat evacuations, again the tissue has to be always sent for a histopathology. Otherwise, for routine termination of pregnancies, we need not do this histological assessment. So sometimes we do see cases where there is a coexistent pregnancy and a molar pregnancy. So ideally, these kind of conditions or these kind of pregnancies should be managed in a tertiary centers, and then we need to consider pre-invasive testing for karyotype. And of course, this condition, it tends to be having adverse outcomes. So early fetal loss is of the rate of 40%, and most of the times they tend to go for a premature delivery or a preterm delivery. So 36% of the cases end up in having a preterm delivery, and in 4 to 20% of the cases there can be associated preeclampsia. So ultimately the live birth rate is only 25% in cases where there is a twin pregnancy coexistent with a molar pregnancy. So whenever we encounter this kind of cases, the ideally these should be managed in a tertiary fetal medicine units, and because the adverse outcomes tend to be a bit high, so in 40% of the cases there can be an early fetal loss or demise, 36% go on to have a preterm deliveries, and even in 4 to 20% there is a risk of preeclampsia, and only 25% end up in having a live birth. So this is an image showing where there is a normal placenta, we have a complete mole. And then having done the management or either suction curettage, so you need to always go for a follow. So the HCG assay has to be done every 2 weeks until this becomes normal. So if the HCG reverts to normal within 56 days of the pregnancy event, so we need to follow up for 6 months from the date of uterine evacuation. So this is important. So if your HCG, so you are supposed to do or monitor the HCG levels every 2 weeks until they become normal. So if it reverts to normal within 56 days of pregnancy event, follow up for 6 months from the date of uterine evacuation. So if not, if it doesn't revert back to normal within 56 days of pregnancy event, so the follow-up should be for 6 months from the normalization of the HCG levels. And also in future pregnancies, so once it is a molar pregnancy and later if a woman conceives, so even after subsequent pregnancies also, so even in future pregnancies also, the HCG levels have to be monitored 6 to 8 weeks after the end of pregnancy. So after any molar pregnancy, so apart from this follow-up, if a woman conceives or if a woman has a subsequent pregnancy after a molar pregnancy, so even after that pregnancy, the HCG levels need to be monitored 6 to 8 weeks after the end of pregnancy. So this is regarding the follow-up after suction curettage. So remember, the HCG assay has to be done every 2 weeks until they become normal. If it reverts back to normal within 56 days of the pregnancy event, the follow-up should be for 6 months from the date of the your procedure. Whereas if not, the follow-up should be for 6 months from the normalization of HCG levels. So coming to the indications for chemotherapy. So having done this procedure and while you are estimating your HCG levels, see sometimes the HCG levels doesn't come back to normal. So if there is a rising HCG in 2 consecutive serum samples, or else if the HCG is more than 20,000 international units per liter even after 4 weeks after your suction curettage, or if the HCG plateaus in 3 consecutive serum samples, or even after 6 months after your procedure, you find there are grossly elevated HCG levels. So when you are doing the HCG follow-up, so if in 2 consecutive serum samples, if there is rising HCG, or if the HCG is very high, that is more than 20,000 international units per liter after 4 weeks after your suction curettage, or the HCG plateaus in 3 consecutive serum samples, or if the HCG levels were increased 6 months after evacuation. So these are the kind of patients wherein you should plan or where chemotherapy is indicated. And also in women where there are brain metastasis or liver or a GIT or lung metastasis more than 2 centimeters on your chest x-ray, or if your histopathology report after suction curettage comes as a choriocarcinoma, so there is a histological evidence of choriocarcinoma, so these patients require chemotherapy. Or else in women who comes to us with heavy vaginal bleeding, or there is a GIT hemorrhage or an intraperitoneal hemorrhage, or where there are pulmonary metastasis or vulval or vaginal metastasis, so you need to always consider giving the chemotherapy. So these are all the indications where your chemotherapy is indicated. So one thing is based on your HCG values, either they are raised or very high even after 6 months, or grossly elevated HCG levels, or if the woman has metastasis either in the liver, brain or the lungs, and if your histopathology report comes as choriocarcinoma, and even if they have a vaginal or a vulval metastasis. So all these, in all these conditions, the woman always requires a chemotherapy. So coming to the FIGO staging of this condition. So stage 1 is the disease is confined to the uterus, whereas in stage 2, this neoplasia extends outside the uterus, but it is limited to the genital structures, like it is just limited to the adnexa or the vagina or the broad ligament. So that is considered to be stage 2. Whereas stage 3 is it tries to extend to the lungs with or without the metastasis, are considered to be the stage 4 GTN. Coming to the FIGO scoring system. So usually we have various parameters in this FIGO scoring system, and it is graded as 0, 1, 2 and 4. So age in years, so less than 40 and equal to or more than 40 years. And what about the antecedent pregnancy, whether it is a molar pregnancy, whether it was a miscarriage, or whether it is a term pregnancy. So your term pregnancy carries a high risk. And then the interval of months from the end of the index pregnancy to the treatment. So the more the interval months, the higher the risk. And then again, of course, it depends upon the pre-treatment serum HCG levels. So the higher the levels, the greater is the risk naturally. And then the largest tumor size, including the uterus. So if the uterus is, the size of the uterus is increased, it is, the risk is increased or the score is high. So if it is equal to or more than 5, it gives or carries a score of 2. And then again the site of metastasis. So if it is a lung metastasis, it is, the score is only 0, whereas if it is a spleen or a kidney metastasis, the score is 1, and the GIT, the score of 2, and if it is liver and brain, the score of 4 is given. And even the number of metastases are considered. So 1 to 4 metastases, a score of 1, 5 to 8, score of 2, and more than 8 metastases, it is 4. And then the other factor that is considered is a previous failed chemotherapy. So whether it is a single drug that has failed, or it is 2 or more drugs. So if it is 2 or more drugs, the score of 4 is given. So these are all the parameters or variables that are considered in the FIGO scoring system, because based on this scoring system, we need to decide whether this woman needs a single agent chemotherapy or a multiple agent chemotherapy. So the factors that are considered in the risk scoring system is the age of the patient, the what is the antecedent pregnancy, and then the interval months between the end of that index pregnancy to your treatment part. And then of course the levels of your HCG, and the size of your the uterus, and then the metastasis, the site of the metastasis is important, and even the number of metastasis is important, and whether the woman has received chemotherapy and there has been any failure. So all these are considered in the FIGO scoring system and given a score. So this is how the choriocarcinoma usually looks. So it is mostly purple, soft purple hemorrhagic mass that we see in choriocarcinoma. So again, it is nothing but the abnormal trophoblastic hyperplasia and anaplasia that we see in this, and there is absence of chorionic villi. There are areas of hemorrhage, there are areas of necrosis, and this choriocarcinoma tends to is always invasive, and there can be a direct invasion into the myometrium and the venous sinuses. And sometimes the woman presents to us again with the same complaint like vaginal bleeding and associated with pain abdomen, or else in a third of women, usually the patient might present to us with the metastatic symptoms like hemoptysis or a headache or seizures, or it is pain in abdomen or vaginal bleeding. So any of those symptoms, with those symptoms also the woman might present. So in one third of the cases, patient do come to us with symptoms of tumor metastasis. So the most common metastasis that we see are in the lungs, the brain, the liver, pelvis, vagina, even the kidney, intestines and spleen. So the metastasis are seen in these unusual sites as well in this condition. So most often it is a soft purple, largely hemorrhagic mass with areas of necrosis, and they try to always invade the myometrium and also the venous sinuses and causing metastasis in different sites. So the woman can present with a vaginal bleeding or sometimes even with symptoms of metastasis. So most often it is a vaginal bleeding with or without abdominal pain, or sometimes with a pelvic mass, and in third of women with features of metastasis. So coming to the investigation, so having known that this is a choriocarcinoma, so what are all the investigations that we are supposed to do? Of course, it is the serum beta HCG. We need to always go for a full blood count, the liver function test, the urea, creatinine and electrolytes, and of course the blood grouping and the rhesus factor or the Rh typing, the thyroid function test, and then we need to do the other imaging part as well to know the site and the number of metastasis. So chest x-ray for pulmonary metastasis, the Doppler ultrasound of the pelvis in case if a woman has a liver metastasis. So you need to always do an ultrasound liver and a CT abdomen in cases of liver metastasis. And in case if a woman has a neurological symptoms or even a lung metastasis, because once it is a metastasis in the lung, there can be associated metastasis in other sites as well. So we need to always do a CT or an MRI brain to rule out the metastasis in these two areas. And of course, sometimes even we can consider doing a CSF HCG level on as well. So these are the battery of investigations that we need to consider once we are thinking in terms of a choriocarcinoma. So apart from the routine blood investigations, so this woman ideally need additional imaging techniques in the form of chest x-ray, the Doppler ultrasound of pelvis, the ultrasound liver, the CT abdomen, and then even a CT or an MRI brain in case if she presents with a neurological symptoms like headache or seizures. Or else if a woman has a pulmonary metastasis, we need to even consider doing a CT or an MRI brain to know whether there are any associated metastatic lesions in the brain. So this is how lung metastasis usually look on chest x-ray, and these are the brain metastasis sometimes we see, and the woman can present with various neurological manifestations. See, these are the sites of metastasis that are present in the liver. So we need to always consider doing an ultrasound liver and even a CT abdomen in case if you are suspecting a liver metastasis. So coming to the treatment of this condition, so based on your FIGO scoring system, so if the score is less than or equal to 6, so these women usually require a single agent chemotherapy, whereas if the score is more than or equal to 7, so these women always require a multi-agent chemotherapy. And in few of the selected cases, apart from the chemotherapy that we consider, so we need to even consider doing a surgery to excise the nodules, or else in case if there is heavy bleeding, we need to even consider doing a selective arterial embolization or a radiotherapy. So in few selected cases, apart from the chemotherapy, they may require a surgery, or a selective arterial embolization or a radiotherapy. So the cure rates of this condition is, in women with low risk, the treatment or the cure rate is almost 100%, whereas if it is a high risk with the score of equal to or more than 7, the cure rates are even good in the form of 95%. So this is the only malignancy where you have a 100% cure. So with low risk GTN, it is 100% cure rate, whereas with a high risk GTN, it is 95% cure rate. So this is the treatment schedule that usually we follow in these cases. So the methotrexate folinic acid treatment schedule. So on alternate days, we give methotrexate and the folinic acid. So the on day one, the methotrexate is 50 milligrams intramuscular at the noon, and day two will be your folinic acid 15 milligrams orally at 6 p.m. So even this, we need to consider the timings as well. So on alternate days, so day 1, 3, 5 and 7, so we give methotrexate alternating with your folinic acid, that is 15 milligrams orally. So this is one regimen, the single agent chemotherapy that we consider for a low risk GTN. Whereas for a high risk GTN, we follow a multi-agent chemotherapy called as IMACO therapy. So IMACO, so etoposide, methotrexate, adriamycin and cyclophosphamide and oncovin or vincristine. So these are the chemotherapeutic agents that we consider for a high risk GTN. So how we give this IMACO regimen? So in week one, so that is on day one, we consider giving dactinomycin, that is 0.5 milligrams intravenous, and etoposide is 100 milligrams per meter square IV, and methotrexate is 300 milligrams per meter square IV. So these three drugs are given on day one in the week one. And on day two, again we give dactinomycin, that is 0.5 milligrams IV, and etoposide is the same dose, that is 100 milligrams per meter square IV, and it has to be alternated with folinic acid. So day one we give methotrexate, so day two we give folinic acid 15 milligrams orally 12th hourly, 4 doses should be given. So starting, so this folinic acid has to be started 24 hours after commencing your methotrexate. So this is on week 1, day 1 you give dactinomycin, etoposide and methotrexate, whereas day 2 you give with folinic acid. So because you need to alternate with methotrexate, so we give on day 2 folinic acid apart from your dactinomycin and etoposide. I hope I am clear. So day week 1. So in week 2, or that is on day 8, so you have finished the week 1. So on day 8, that is week 2, you give this vincristine, that is 1.4 milligrams per meter square, a maximum of 2 milligrams can be considered, and cyclophosphamide is 600 milligrams per meter square. So these two drugs are given on day 8. So this is your IMACO therapy for a high risk GTN where the score is equal to or more than 7. I think I am clear with this treatment schedule. So for a low risk GTN, it is the single agent chemotherapy that we consider. So it is methotrexate alternating with folinic acid. Whereas for a high risk GTN, we need to always go for a multi agent chemotherapy, that is IMACO regimen. So in week 1, day 1, dactinomycin, etoposide with methotrexate is given. Whereas on day 2, dactinomycin, etoposide and folinic acid is given. Whereas on day 8, we give the other two drugs, that is the vincristine or oncovin and the cyclophosphamide. So this is your IMACO regimen for multi or the multi-agent regimen for a high-risk GTN. Of course, this is the graph showing how your HCG levels initially, you know, once whenever you administer or give methotrexate, usually we initially see a surge or a rise in your HCG levels, but then the levels tend to follow and reaches a plateau. This is the trend that we usually expect or see once we give a methotrexate. And then having given the regimen, so we need to always check or go for HCG levels. So we need to do twice weekly in a case of choriocarcinoma, and then whatever chemotherapy that has been given, it has to be continued for 3 cycles. That is, she needs 6 weeks consolidation chemotherapy. So coming to the role of surgery, so 50% of high-risk GDN patients require surgery. So almost 50% of high-risk GDN patients require surgery. So it is the surgery is to remove the resistant or the persistent disease that is present in the uterus or in the other metastatic sites. And also the other thing is to reduce the uterine tumor load, we need to go for a surgery. And whenever a woman has a profuse hemorrhage from the tumor, so to control, we need to always consider a surgery. And also if a woman has symptoms because of the bowel or urinary obstruction due to the presence of a large tumor bulk, again we need to resort to a surgery in cases of GDN. So 50% of the woman with high risk GDN might require surgery. So surgery is to remove the resistant or the persistent disease in the uterus or in the metastatic sites. And also the other thing is to decrease the uterine tumor load as such. And whenever if a woman has a torrential bleeding from the site or from the tumor site, we need to always go for this selective arterial embolization. Or else in few of the women, because of the bulk mass, because of the presence of this tumor, it can cause bowel or a urinary tract obstruction. So to relieve this bowel and urinary tract obstruction, so we need to remove this large tumor bulk. So to relieve the symptoms of this obstruction because of the presence of this large tumor mass, so we need to go for a surgery. So surgical bleed application or the arterial ligation in cases of bleeding from the tumor. So we need to consider either a surgical bleed application or an arterial ligation. And in cases where we find there are large theca lutein cysts or large cysts, so sometimes if these cysts undergo torsion, so usually they present with a sudden acute onset of abdominal pain. So in those cases, we should consider doing an ovarian cystectomy or sometimes a salpingo-oophorectomy. And 1 in 140 patients require hysterectomy because of the uncontrolled hemorrhage that we see in this condition sometimes. So 1 in 140 patients require even a hysterectomy. So coming to the role of radiotherapy, so to prevent unexpected bleeding, especially in the brain metastasis, we need to consider radiotherapy. So the treatment is 4000 centigrays given in fractions, multiple fractions, so 10 to 20 fractions. So in each fraction, 200 to 300 centigrays is given. So it is, the radiotherapy is given in multiple fractions, so small doses. And also apart from the radiotherapy, we always give steroids. So steroid cover is to be given to reduce the associated cerebral edema. And then of course selective arterial embolization in case if there is any intractable or uncontrollable bleeding from either of the uterine, vaginal or a hepatic metastasis. And sometimes if a tumor is resistant to your methotrexate or methotrexate, usually that is a single or the first agent of choice. So in case if there is any resistance, we need to go for a second line chemotherapy. And again, the choice of your chemotherapy again depends upon the HCG levels. So if the HCG levels are less than 300 international units per liter, so we can consider giving a daptomycin. And if the HCG level is more than 300, we need to again go for a combination chemotherapy. So coming to the follow-up, so ideally either serum or urine HCG has to be taken twice weekly during the treatment, and then after the treatment stops, the serum and urine HCG are to be measured weekly for 6 weeks. And at the sixth week, always do an ultrasound Doppler of the pelvis, a chest X-ray, CT, MRI if they are abnormal at presentation. So at 6 weeks, if a woman has any of the atypical presentations or if they have any abnormal presentations, then we need to always consider doing an ultrasound Doppler of the pelvis or a chest X-ray or a CT MRI to know whether there are any metastases. So serum and urine HCG are taken twice weekly during the treatment, and after the treatment stops, the serum and urine HCG are measured weekly for 6 weeks. And at the 6th week, based on the presentation, we need to consider doing additional imaging techniques. So the follow-up is year 1, the 2 weekly serum and urine HCG at 2 to 6 months, and then 2 weekly urine HCG between 7 to 12 months. So that is in the year 1, we need to always do this way. And in the year 2, monthly urine HCG. Every month you need to do HCG in the year 2. And in the year 3, every 2 months. And year 4, every 3 months. And in the year 5, 4 monthly urine HCG. And from 6th year till lifelong. So she, once it is a choriocarcinoma or a GTN, so always she needs a lifelong follow. So after 6th year, at the 6th year and lifelong, she needs to always do a 6th monthly or 6 monthly urine HCG. And in the initial 12 months, first 12 months, always we need to consider a contraception. So this is the follow-up after a choriocarcinoma or a GTN. So in the year 1, we need to be always, our monitoring to be a bit intensive. So 2 weekly serum and urine HCG between 2 to 6 months, and from 6 months or the 7th month to till 1 year, 2 weekly urine HCG. And in the year 2, monthly, year 3, 2 monthly, year 4, 3 monthly, and so on. So the coming to the outcome of treatment, so sometimes we do see the relapse rates. So the relapse rates with the low risk is 2%, with high risk is 3%. And even if it is a relapse, in 68 to 80% of the cases, it tends to be of the same histological type. And the most important advice that these women always need is always advise not to conceive. So till her follow-up is complete, advise her not to conceive. So this is the important bit of advice that these women should always receive from us. So advised not to conceive until follow-up is complete, and then advise not to conceive for at least a year after completion of chemotherapy. So most often methotrexate, or sometimes may some women might even be given a multi-agent chemotherapy. So few of the drugs are gonadotoxic, few of the drugs are usually cause multiple fetal anomalies. So usually these women should be advised not to conceive for at least a year after completion of chemotherapy. So these two bits of advice should always be told or informed to the patient. So there is a risk of relapse. So 2% with low risk, 3% with the high risk, and advised not to conceive till she finishes the complete follow-up. And in case if chemotherapy is given, and this woman ideally should not conceive at least for a year. And what about the long-term outcomes? So having been given chemotherapy, either a single agent or a multiple agent, so what is the usual long-term outcome for these women? So mostly these women tend to have early menopause if they have received multi-agent chemotherapy, because few of the drugs that we give in the IMACO regimen tend to be gonadotoxic. So they can have early menopause. And in women who have been given this, again, this multi-agent chemotherapeutic agents, there is a risk of having secondary cancers. So acute myeloid leukemia or colon cancer, melanoma and breast cancer. So these are the cancers, secondary cancers that we see once a woman receives IMACO regimen. So these are the long-term outcomes that we usually tend to see. So either early menopause, or few of the women end up having a secondary cancer. So it is either AML or colon cancer, melanoma or a breast cancer. So but in case if a woman receives this IMACO regimen, and if
lower back of the neonate, they find a discolored patch. This patch will be flat, it will not be raised above the surface of the skin. Because it is not raised above the surface of the skin, we call it as macule. If it is raised above the surface of the skin, it becomes papular plaque. So this discolored patch over the lower back is known as Mongolian spot. It can be big, it can be sometimes multiple. Though the name is Mongolian spot, it has nothing to do with Down syndrome, where you get mongoloid faces and all. So it has nothing to do with that. It's a benign lesion. It doesn't cause any pain, it doesn't cause any itching, it doesn't spread. Over a period of time, by the end of infancy, these Mongolian spots gradually fade away, sometimes much earlier. So Mongolian spots are one such benign neonatal lesions. The other common neonatal benign lesions are, the second one which mentions very important thing is what is known as erythema toxicum. See, we are enumerating benign neonatal lesions and the name is erythema toxicum. Though the name is toxic, the condition is benign. Erythema toxicum are small, punctate, little bigger lesions surrounded by erythematous base. There is erythematous base and in between there is something like a small punctum or lesion. These are common over the trunk, face. They can be multiple. So when the attender, mother or caregiver looks at them, so some red spots in between, there is one some yellowish or whitish dot is there. They may feel that it is allergic, they may feel that it is infective, they may feel so many things, they may attribute that to certain things. They may feel that it may be painful, it may be causing some itching sensation, etc. Attenders will feel like that. But in reality, it will not have any symptoms. It is not associated with any symptoms. It's a painless condition, non-itchy, non-pruritic one. It doesn't require any treatment, same like Mongolian spot. No treatment is required. It disappears on its own in 2-3 days. Even if it recurs, again it will disappear. So erythema toxicum in neonates is a benign condition. One more benign condition that can be seen is, one is what is known as palatal or Epstein pulse. So over the hard palate, tiny, discrete, pearly means shining, the mucosa over it is stretched, it appears shiny. Lesions can be there over the palate. So the mother may notice while breastfeeding or something, she will just see that okay, some small spots are there over the palate. She is worried whether they will grow, what has happened, etc. These are again benign conditions, no treatment is required, they will disappear on its own, they will not cause pain, they will not hinder with feeding. Palatal pearls, pearls because they are shiny, they are seen on the palate. Similar lesions can be seen in over the scrotum also. So for the common name can be Epstein pearls. So Epstein pearls can be present either over the palate or over the scrotum. They are benign, no treatment is required. Then why are we talking about such lesions, benign lesions? None of them require treatment, all of them disappear on their own. Why we are talking about them is, they are so common an occurrence that every neonate may have one of them, maybe more also. The second thing is, the caregivers, the parents, attenders, when they notice this, they are worried. If somebody examines them and then reassures, counsels them that okay, this is such a lesion, it is a benign one, nothing needs to be done, then they will be reassured. Otherwise, unknowingly somebody may start unwanted treatment for such conditions, and such a treatment initiated may in turn cause some harm. So in order to prevent such things, unwanted harm, so that is the reason why we need to know clearly about such conditions. So as I have told, three conditions, Mongolian spots, erythema, toxicum, Epstein's purse. There may be one, two more other such similar conditions which I would urge that you people read. One more such thing could be neonatal jaundice. We told no physiological jaundice. It is not present on first day. It disappears by 14th day. There is no incompatibility. No treatment is required. Palms and soles are not affected. But somebody has to examine the child, collect the details about the neonate, compare the mother's blood group with the baby's blood group, and then reassure the parents that this is a physiological entity, nothing needs to be tensed about. Then only they will be reassured. Otherwise, unnecessary, unwanted investigations and treatments may happen over such benign neonatal conditions. That is the importance of this. Now let us look at one more entity. A swelling over the scalp. A swelling over the scalp in a neonate. Two common entities will come to our mind. One of them is known as cephal hematoma. So the name itself says that hematoma. Hematoma means collection of blood, extravasation of the blood. Blood has come out of the blood vessels and it is now extravasated, it has collected in a particular layer. The second one is caput succedaneum. Caput succedaneum is related to the process of birth. So the most dependent part in our text presentation, the most dependent part will become edematous, swollen, and that is referred to as caput succedaneum. So what about caput succedaneum is? Caput succedaneum is present at birth. It is present over the most dependent part of the vertex. And if we look at the pathology, it is collection of interstitial fluid, edematous fluid, in the loose areolar tissue of the scalp. Scalp has five layers, the third layer is loose areolar tissue. When there is collection of this edematous fluid in that loose areolar tissue, because the head is compressed, that is known as caput succedaneum. What will happen to this caput succedaneum after birth? We said that it is because of the physical nature by which the head or the vertex is compressed that the most dependent part will become edematous. And we said that it is present right at birth. After birth, those physical constraints are no more present over the vertex. So gradually this caput succedaneum has to recede. So caput succedaneum is a swelling which is present over the most dependent part. It is most prominent at birth, gradually decreases. If we look at cephal hematoma, first it need not be present at birth. So some trauma will happen during the process of birth, which will lead to small extravasation of blood beneath the fifth layer of the scalp. The fifth layer of the scalp is periosteum. Periosteum is adherent to the underlying bone. So subperiosteal, beneath the periosteum, small amount of blood starts trickling and collecting. So at birth there is no visible swelling present. But because the process of bleeding continues even after birth, the swelling may manifest on second day, third day, fifth day, etc. So the caput succedaneum was present at birth, cephalohematoma need not be present at birth. Caput succedaneum gradually decreases from birth, cephalohematoma, even if it is manifest, it may increase after birth. Caput succedaneum was because of loose areolar connective tissue and fluid there. Cephalohematoma is because of subperiosteal bleed. We never spoke of any underlying fracture or something for caput succedaneum. But cephalohematoma, there is a possibility of an underlying fracture. Wherever the swelling is there, underneath that it may be overlying, the swelling may be overlying the fracture site. And because cephalohematoma is collection of blood, it can cause exaggeration of physiological jaundice. It may cause increase in the jaundice that is otherwise happening. Caput succedaneum will not have such complication. Cephalohematoma, because it is a collection of blood and blood is a good culture for organisms to grow, there is a risk of infection, abscess formation with cephalohematoma. No such risk with caput succedaneum. And because cephalohematoma is caused by trauma directly to the skull bones, it need not be present over the presenting part or the most dependent part. It can be anywhere else. So somebody is applying the forceps. The forceps may dent, damage the bone leading to cephalohematoma. It need not be present on the most presenting part or the dependent part. Right. So these are some key differences between cephalohematoma and caput succedaneum. And we should also realize that when we are recording the head circumference of a neonate at birth, what was the weight? So baby is born, you weigh the child, so you will get birth weight. You want to know the length. Baby is born, you stabilize, essential newborn care is provided, then you measure the length. That is the length. But for head circumference, we wait for 24 hours. We record the head circumference at birth after 24 hours because of 2-3 reasons. The first reason, the likely, most likely, is that during the process of birth there must be some mounding, overlapping of the skull bones. So this may alter the head circumference. We want that mounding to regress. Second thing, there could be caput succedaneum. So we want caput succedaneum to regress. And whenever we are measuring the head circumference, we need to look for such scalp swelling. Cephalohematoma might have appeared. That may erroneously contribute to head circumference. So these few precautions are to be taken. Few such points need to be borne in our mind when we record head circumference at birth. Now let us look at one more important entity. So today's class, in the first part we discussed about few benign neonatal conditions. In the second part we have briefly looked at scalp swellings and differences between caput succedaneum and cephalhematoma. And in the third aspect, let us now consider one important aspect of presentation of a neonate. A mother whose neonate is around 10 days old, she has come for follow up. Maybe she has a gynecologist or somebody, they have asked that you come after some days. Maybe they have given episiotomy or they want to see how it is healing, or she has underwent some cesarean, so they want to see the follow up. So, whatever, some reason she has come to the hospital with her neonate on 8th or 10th day. So she wants the newborn also to be examined. So this newborn is examined now after 10th day. So when the weight is checked, yes, all precautions are taken so that all clots are removed. We ensure that the environment is not very cold or very too hot for the neonate. So without any clots, when the neonate is weighed on the 10th day, the mother is surprised. Birth weight was 2.7 kg and after 10 days it is still 2.7 kg. Now she is worried because she thinks that after 10 days also how the weight is same. The baby is feeding well, breast milk is sufficient according to her. So why the baby is not gaining weight, she thinks. And because she is thinking, she arrives at the answer. She has noticed that after some feeds, when she put her baby to sleep, she has noticed that the baby will have some vomiting, regurgitation or vomiting. Some amount of milk comes out of the mouth. This she has noticed. Now she is very much worried. Oh, those vomitings are responsible for this absence of weight gain. So what should be the right approach to her? Do you feel that yes, there is a worrisome factor here because the child is not gaining weight after 10 days? Do you all feel so? Or do you feel that no, everything is fine with the child, mother is unnecessarily apprehensive, nothing needs to be done? Yes, even if we feel that nothing needs to be done, what needs to be done is this fact should be conveyed to the mother so that she understands and accepts it, and mother's anxiety should be allayed. Right? So even if we are very sure, so we just say that no, no, don't worry, go home. But she will not stop worrying because we haven't explained her why she should stop worrying. So what are the points here? The first point is, yes, every neonate will lose its weight after birth for first 3 or 4 days. So on first day, if the weight is 2.7 kg, by 3rd or 4th day, the weight will decrease. Correct. Anyway, it is going to decrease. No. Now on 4th day, we have seen a 2.7 kg child and it is now 2 kg. Is it okay? No, it's not okay. This weight loss, postnatal weight loss, which is because of loss of excess fluid in the body, this should not exceed 10%. Should not exceed. It doesn't mean that it should be 10% only. It should be less than 10%, maybe 7%, 5%, something. Not even 10%. So 2.7 kg child, 10% will be 270 grams. So this child should not go below 2430 grams. So if it has become 2.5 kg, then 5. So it has lost some weight, maybe 200 grams over first 3 or 4 days. In the next 6-7 days, it will regain that much weight. It had lost that weight, That much weight in 3 or 4 days, but to regain it will take some 7 days. So by the end of 10th day, approximately there about, it would have regained the birth weight. Right? So now we have told her, okay, your child would have lost weight and now gained weight. It had excessive fluid at birth, that fluid is gone, now this weight gain is what you can be satisfied, happy. This is not just because of water logging, etc., so it is good. But still one worry remains for her, that her child is regurgitating, vomiting after feeds. Yes, now is the time that we should advise her. We should first inquire whether she knows about burping, whether she is practicing burping. Burping is the process of putting the child, taking the child vertically over the shoulder after the feed and patting, tapping between the shoulder blades, so that whatever air the child would have possibly swallowed along with breastfeeding, that air is regurgitated out. Only air will not come out, some amount of milk also will come out, but our purpose is to remove that air. And we need to reassure that the amount, small amount of milk that comes out during this burping process is very small, very negligible, and it will not affect the weight gain, and it is a physiological entity. She shouldn't confuse that with vomiting. Now she is happy. Even if she is happy, there may be an element of doubt still persisting in her thought process. So what is the best demonstrable way that to tell her that, okay, your child is getting adequate breastfeeding? We had discussed in our initial classes, in order to assess this adequacy of breastfeeding, we wanted to know whether she is feeding from only one breast at a time or both breasts at a time. We had seen that she should feed from only one breast at a time so that the child will get both the foremilk as well as hind milk from that breast, and the other breast can be used for the next session of feeding. Then we had said that the neonate need to pass a minimum of around 6 to 8 urinations in 24-hour day cycle. So if the child is passing 10 urines, 12 urines, 14 urines, that is good enough. Then we also had said that after a satisfactory feed, the baby neonate usually sleeps for 1.5 to 2.5 hours, on an average 2 hours, sometimes even 3 hours. So that is one more way how she can assess. Okay, she now says that I feed from only one breast at a time. My neonate feeds for around 8 to 10 minutes, not more than that. Then I do burping. Then when I put to sleep, he sleeps for 2 to 2.5 hours. He is passing around 12-14 urinations per day. So these are all ways to assess adequacy of breastfeeding. And over a period of time, say after a week or maybe after 10 days, we can weigh the child and see that there is a weight gain. Right? But only thing is, when you are assessing urine output, when you are assessing sleep, when you are assessing the burping, when you are looking at the duration of breastfeed, when you are looking at whether one breast is used or both breasts are used, these can be done on day-to-day basis. But weight gain has to be over a cumulative period, say something like 1 week or 10 days or so. No, it is not recommended that for such an otherwise normal neonate, where we are only looking at adequacy of breastfeeding, there is no need to weigh the child every day, no need. Right? So this child at 10 days of life, we have reassured the mother and she has gone back. She comes after 10 more days, so now the neonate is around 20 days. Now you weigh the child. And the child's weight, which was initially 2.7 kg at birth and at 10 days, both it was 2.7 kg. Now it is around 3 kg. So she will ask, weight aithe perigindi, whether it is satisfied. Yes, on an average, neonates will gain 10 grams per kilogram of their body weight per day. 10 grams per kilogram of their birth weight per day. So this child was 2.7 kg. So if it is 10 grams per kilogram, this child has to give 27 grams per day for 10 days. So 270 grams. So it should have been around 300 grams, 270 or 300. So that is why it is reaching around 3 kilograms. So it is satisfied. So average weight gain per day is 10 gram per kilogram of birth weight per day. So if the child was weighing only 2 kg at birth, then it will grow at 20 grams initially. Later on it will pick up. So if it was 3 or 3.5, then it gains 30 to 35 grams per day. Right. Initially. Okay, this aspect is now settled. We have some knowledge about initial weight loss, subsequent regaining of birth weight by 10th day, role of burping, etc., and how to assess adequacy of breastfeeding. So maybe you consider that this is another child, not the same child. Okay, let's say that it's another child. This mother is intelligent. She has been guided well also. She knows about burping. She knows that there will be initial weight loss. Birth weight is regained by 10th day or so. All that has happened and she is fine. She is doing exclusive breastfeeding. She is doing burping after the feeds. Now her neonate is around 22 days old. This is her first neonate, first child. And she says, notices that now the vomitings after feeds are happening around 10 minutes after birth, 5 minutes after birth. Despite her burping the child taking out that swallowed air from the mouth, and later on she is putting the child to sleep, she still notices that despite burping, despite adequate burping, the child is having vomitings. So 1 or 2 days she thought that okay, something, she didn't bother much. Third day again it is persistent. So now she has brought this child to the OPD. Already burping has been set right. She is only having exclusive breastfeeding. So what could be the reason that the child is having vomitings? And we said that this is her first child, male child. Then the pediatrician or the person who examines, the doctor who examines, he asks her whether the regurgitated, the vomited food, how is it? She says that it is almost milk-like. Not much change, maybe a little curdling may happen sometimes, or it is only the milk that comes out. And but naturally, like most of the questions associated with vomiting, she is asked whether the vomitus is bile stained, whether it is greenish. She says no. Then for some reason at that time, not much importance is given to that. Some examination is done, they find that nothing is wrong. So they are advised to continue burping and come back after 5 days. She comes back after 5 days. Now the vomitings are for 7 days. And she is very particular that now vomitings have actually in fact increased. She feels that morning time the child vomits less and subsequent feeds the vomitus increases in quantity. And now she has also, the mother has also noticed a change in pattern of the neonate's stools. She now feels that the earlier whatever stools which a neonate was passing, now those stools have become more harder, more solidified, and small pellet-like stools are there. Pellet-like. Because some weight was recorded 5 days back, they again record the weight now. We were hoping for some weight gain. It is not even constant, weight has come down. On palpation, on examination, the child looks dehydrated and the doctor finds that there is a almond shaped, almond sized mass palpable in right hypochondria. So they ask for ultrasound, which confirms that the pylorus is thickened. They mention certain things about the length of the pylorus, etc. And because the pylorus is thickened, that is the reason why it is felt like a mass. And a diagnosis of congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis is made. So, about congenital pyloric hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, it is common in firstborn males, usually presents around 3rd week. Initially it appears like there is an inadequate burping, but despite adequate burping, vomitings will persist. They are non-bilious vomitings. Down the line, child will lose weight. The stools will be hard pellet-like. And if an investigation is performed, of course we did mention the ultrasound. If some blood investigations are performed, see what would have happened? The child is repeatedly vomiting. Repeated vomitings means repeated loss of gastric juice. Gastric secretions, gastric juices are rich in hydrochloric acid, HCl. So the child is losing hydrogen, the child is losing chlorides. So the child will have hypochloremic, chlorides are lost. Child is losing hydrogen, so alkalosis child will develop. And down the line, the body will try to retain hydrogen by exchanging it with potassium. So the child will lose potassium. So child will have hypokalemic, hyperchloremic, hypochloremic metabolic alkalosis. So hypokalemic metabolic alkalosis the child is having. The child is having repeated vomitings, non-bilious, starting in the 3rd week of life, and an almond-shaped sized mass is felt in the right hypochondria. Ultrasound will be a very simple method to diagnose, confirm the diagnosis. The treatment is very simple, a small surgery where they just excise the hypertrophied pylorus. The mucosa is also not penetrated, only the hypertrophic muscular layer is a cut is done. Pyloromyotomy. And it is said that within 10-15 minutes of performing this procedure, feeding can be initiated. Because the mucosa is not open, the bowel is not exposed to outside. Ramstedt's surgery, it is known as Ramstedt's pyloromyotomy. Sometimes when while awaiting for surgery, or when surgery cannot be done immediately, child is having some cough, cold, it wants it to settle. There is a role, very small role, for medicinal management of this condition by the administering oral atropine. Oral administration of atropine gives a palliative relief for this only for some time. It is not a cure of any nature. So, congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis, this is the usual presentation. This is how it has to be diagnosed. I would suggest you people read about X-ray appearance. Where do you get single bubble appearance, double bubble appearance, etc. So this is about congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. This is today we also spoke bit about benign neonatal lesions. We looked at differences between cephal hematoma and caput succedaneum, right? So in subsequent classes, next classes, we will be starting a new system. Probably we will start with endocrinology. Okay. Thank you for your patience.